Okay, good morning to everyone. Today we'll start with the topic protein structure. The topics will be databases. We'll talk about the primary, secondary and tertiary databases for proteins. And then we'll move ahead with the topic called protein structure prediction. How we can go with the structure prediction of proteins, and that will include both secondary structure prediction as well as tertiary structure prediction. Okay, so right now I'll just start with the introduction to proteins. That will be, I'll talk today about the structure. Okay, we have discussed about the structure of proteins earlier also, because we have talked about the various biomolecules, about the metabolism of biomolecules. So we have talked about that a protein is actually something which is made up of number of amino acids. It is said to be a polypeptide chain. The amino acids, they are connected to each other by the help of peptide bond. And so they just go with the preparation of this polypeptide chain. But if we talk about that, how this protein is there in the body and what about its role? So we need to go with the structure analysis of these proteins. Okay, with the category of biomolecules, we can just say that proteins, they belong to the category of these macromolecules. Okay, and they consist of one or more long chain of amino acid residue. As I told you just now, that they are actually connected by the help of peptide bonds, and one amino acid is connected to the other amino acid. The carboxyl group of one amino acid, it actually interacts with the amino group of the second amino acid, and the water molecule is actually being removed, and thus a peptide bond is being prepared. And like this, one amino acid is connected to other, with the third one, with the fourth one, and so on, just trying to prepare a polypeptide chain. Okay. The second thing is that protein, because we are studying about the protein, what about the structure of protein, we need to understand that protein is having multiple functions in our body. Okay, in all the organisms, you will find protein is there, and protein is helping in various metabolic reactions. It is actually acting as enzyme, catalyzing various metabolic pathways. It is there in the gene expression process. We are very much aware that under the central dogma, we have studied how the gene, the DNA are expressed and how the proteins are formed. But at every point, we need to understand that there are inducers, there are repressors, there are promoters, and protein is acting somehow in all the parts, and it is also acting as enzyme, providing the concept of initialization or just triggering the process somehow. Okay, and the other function includes that protein is also helpful as the part of the structure of cell. So it is one of the component of the cell structure as well. Okay, and it also helps with the transportation of various molecules. So if you talk about the transportation of molecules, we are talking about molecules, they want to travel from one cell to the other cell, or from one location to the other location. So what protein is doing, it is acting as a transporter as well. Okay, so protein, as I discussed, it is a sequence of amino acids, but it is actually being related with the sequence of nucleotides as well. We are very much aware, you must have studied in the last session yesterday, that actually we were talking about central dogma, that how DNA is being transcribed into RNA, and what about the translation and how proteins are actually being formed. Okay, so somehow proteins, they are directly connected to these nucleotides. The coding regions, the coded part of these DNAs, they are actually converting into these proteins. Okay, but proteins in nature, we'll talk about the different types of structures of proteins, but proteins in nature, they are there in its, in their three-dimensional state. Okay, and this is the state by which we can just determine what is the activity of protein. So protein, if it is there in any living organism, it is there in its three-dimensional structure. But there are certain other levels of protein structure as well. So there is this primary level, secondary level, tertiary level is there. Then we are having this quaternary level. We have discussed this earlier also. So the linear sequence is said to be the primary structure. Then there are regions of local regularity, where we are considering that there are three kinds of structures. There is helix, there is a beta strand or sheets, and there are turns or coils. So this makes the secondary structure of proteins. Okay, then there are super secondary structures as well, where these combinations, these helixes, these sheets, and these coils or turns, they are actually being connected to each other, and they are preparing some more complicated structures like beta barrels, the beta alpha, beta units, the Greek keys. Okay, so they are supposed to be under the category of super secondary, but the tertiary structure of protein is something which is actually a chain that is folded and that is packing all these secondary structure elements, the helixes, the sheets and coils. And this is how the structure looks like. There are these torsion angles, psi, phi, omega, and there are these interactive forces like hydrophobic, van der Waal, ionic interactions that is making these three-dimensional structure of protein a stabler structure. Then there are quaternary structure. We are going to study the structure of protein in the quaternary level as well. Because when we talk about the structure of protein at the quaternary level, we mean actually by that there are separate chains, there are number of chains, and all these chains, all these molecules are together producing a single protein, like for example hemoglobin. Okay, hemoglobin is having multiple alpha helixes as well as beta sheets. And then there is this quaternary structure. This is a new type, and this is something where we are considering that protein is there, it is interacting with some other protein, okay, or it is interacting with some other nucleic acids. Okay, so this kind of structure comes under the quaternary structure. So when we will proceed with the databases, because majorly we'll just talk about the protein databases. Okay, so wherever we'll search for databases, we'll go with the chain of amino acids as well. Okay, so how to read those amino acids? You will not find those amino acids in a single letter, in these triplet codons. Okay, these ye jo three letter amino acid representation hai, this won't be there. Okay, what you will see is these is the single letter code. Like for example, for glycine, you will not get the three letter code, that is GLY, you will get the code as G. If you're talking about arginine, you'll get the code R. So you need to read the single letter codes like this in this format. You need to understand that all these 20 amino acids, they are read by a single letter code. Okay. The same will be there in our FASTA format as well. We'll just discuss about the FASTA format in our practicals again. So actually the need for, what was the need? What was the need for going with the analysis or the structure prediction process was because while investigating the sequences, there were actually two approaches that were being used. Okay, the first approach was the pattern recognition approach, and the second approach was said to be the ab initio prediction approach. Okay, so pattern recognition is an approach which is actually used to detect the similarity. Pattern recognition helps us when we are having one and two, we are trying to find the similarity between two sequences or more than two sequences, just because we know that if there is similarity in sequences, then obviously there will be similarity in the structure as well as functions. Okay, so while investigating with the structure of any protein or any other molecule, we need to understand that first thing is we need to go with the process of pattern recognition, trying to find out all the similarity that can be there between the two sequences. Okay, but the second thing is the ab initio prediction. This also helps us to go with the study of any kind of structure. It can be a protein structure or it can be any other molecule. Okay, so when we are going with the analysis or the prediction as in we are trying to find out, we are just hypothetically considering that the structure may be like this, it will appear like this. Okay, so we are just predicting, we are not sure, the surety is not of 100%, the prediction is almost around 60 to 70%, we are considering that this structure may be like this in actual. Okay, in reality, it can be like this, it will appear like this. So trying to deduce the structure, what about the role of all the amino acids, how they look like, they are preparing helixes, sheets, loops or coils at which section. So that all can be done by ab initio. Ab initio is something that we are considering about the in silico study. where we'll be using bioinformatics tools, we'll be using bioinformatics softwares. So everything will be done virtually, okay, by the help of technology of computer sciences. Okay, and by this, as soon as we just go with the reduction of any kind of protein structure or any molecular structure, we need to understand that if there is similarity, or we have got the information with respect to a sequence or structure, we will definitely get the information with respect to function. Because we can just compare our structure or our sequence with those which are present in the database already. Okay, so I talked about the protein data bank earlier, and it is a kind of a tertiary structure database. So this will definitely help to go with the prediction of any new protein for which we don't have the tertiary structure. Okay, so both these methods are different. Actually, I discussed about both these methods. So the sequence and structure based pattern recognition will definitely help us to go with the prediction process, and they will just help us to understand how the structure is related, how the function can be analyzed. Okay, the prediction methods, okay, they just don't consider the templates when they are going with the process of prediction. So we are not considering the template databases. Okay, the deduction is directly. Okay, so what is a template is, you need to understand that template is actually a molecule or a structure which we are considering as a standard molecule. Okay, and based on the structure or the function or the information that we collect from that particular sequence or structure, we can go with the process of prediction. Okay, but in case of ab initio prediction, there are methods where you'll see that we are not considering any kind of template sequence or template structure. Okay, so what about the categories of biological databases? We talked about SwissProt or the UniProt. We talked about different databases. Okay, here you can see it is a general category. If we talk about biological databases, then there are these four kinds of databases. There are primary data sources, there are composite sequence databases, there are secondary pattern databases, composite pattern databases. Okay, so all these databases are there, but all these databases, you need to understand that in case of primary sequence databases, it will talk about the two kinds, the nucleic acids or the proteins. So we are having these number of databases. We are having EMBL, GenBank and DDBJ, like we have discussed it in our last lecture yesterday. And we are having our SwissProt, PIR, MIPS, TR, EMBL and NRL3D. Okay, so SwissProt and TR, EMBL, it is there at the common side, that is our UniProt knowledge base. And they are providing the information with respect to the primary sequence of database. That is, the information which we are getting is in a linear format. We will just have the information with respect to the amino acid chain. Okay, so what is the, then the other thing is, every database, it has its own format. Okay, so we need to understand that whenever we are going with the analysis process, with the retrieval of information and trying to go with any kind of prediction, whether it is a secondary structure prediction or it is a tertiary structure prediction, then we need to understand that we need to go with the format that is feasible for our software or our tool. Okay, so I'll start with the primary protein sequences. PIR is one of the primary protein sequence database. Okay, so this is said to be the protein information resource. Okay, and this is maintained by the Georgetown University Medical Center. It is actually working for the bioinformatics resources, and it is working for both the areas, for genomic research as well as for proteomic research. So it was actually being established long back in 1984, and NBRF is actually maintaining this, and it started with this particular database. And this was the database, actually it was having all those macromolecules which were there in the first protein database, that was Atlas of Protein Sequence and Structure. We talked about this particular database. Margaret Dayhoff was the person who gave this database. This was the first protein database, and all the information which was there in this database, the PIR, it collected the information, and a new database was being prepared. Okay, this database is actually also taking the information with respect to the evolutionary relationship among the proteins. If there are proteins and proteins are having any kind of evolutionary relationship, so the protein information resource database, it is collecting that information and it is just submitting, collecting those proteins in itself. Okay, so if we talk about the PIR, so PIR, the protein information resource, it is actually divided into the four sections. Okay, there are four levels, and these four levels, they are having certain information. Okay, the first level is totally about the fully classified and annotated entries. You will have all the detailed information with respect to the protein. PIR2 section will include only the preliminary entries. Okay, and on this section, you will have sequences which will not be thoroughly reviewed. Possibly they are just submitted, okay, because it is at the primary level. So it can be a possibility they are not reviewed, and it can be a possibility that you will get the same sequence again. So redundancy or repetition of these sequences can be a possibility in case of PIR2. Then the third one is PIR3. So in case of PIR3, you can see there are unverified entries as well. Okay, there can be entries which have not been reviewed earlier, but the database, they are just keeping it in their level PIR3. Okay, so these are the different levels. The submission is there, they are keeping it in different levels, but the most refined one is our PIR1, which is the most classified one and the most annotated one. And the fourth category, the fourth section, the PIR4, it is having the four categories. There are the translation copies of the sequences, like nucleotide, it went with the translation. So PIR4 is having those translated copies of our nucleotides in the form of proteins. Then there are translations of sequences that can be not transcribed or translated in reality. Okay, then protein sequences, which are actually there in an extensively genetically engineered manner, they are also there in our PIR4 sections. Okay, another section, the fourth section of this PIR4 is where we will find sequences that are not genetically encoded as well, and they are not produced on the ribosomes. So all these types of protein sequences, they are there deposited in this PIR database. Okay, the second database in the primary category is the MIPS, Martinshide Institute for Protein Sequences, the Max Planck Institute for Biochemistry. It is actually maintaining this particular database, okay, and it is collecting and processing and distributing all sort of protein sequence database with the tripartite. Actually, this is a kind of a consortium which is being maintained by the PIR International Protein Sequence Database. So under this consortium, MIPS is also coming, PIR is also coming, and the information is actually being exchanged with these within these databases. So if the information is collected in PIR, it can be exchanged with MIPS. If some sort of information is collected in MIPS, so it is being exchanged with PIR again. Okay, so MIPS is contributing nearly about 50% of the data input in this consortium. Okay, so initially, if we talk about this MIPS, so MIPS, what it was, the information on MIPS was distributed on CD-ROM together with the PatchX, which is actually a kind of a supplement, and it is working as an external source while compiling the information with respect to protein sequences. This MIPS is working along with the PatchX. It is a kind of a supplement server which is working. Here you can also see the URL for this particular database. And it is helping us to go with the process of homology identification as well. And that is providing the information with respect to similarity of sequences. Okay, so NRL3D is something which is being produced by all those sequences, which will be supposed that the sequences which are there in this particular database will have their three-dimensional structures deposited in the protein data bank. Okay, so all those structures which are there in protein data bank, those structures will have the primary sequences and which are there in this particular database, that is NRL3D. It is again being maintained by the same consortium, the PIR International Consortium, and all the sequences which are there deposited in this database, they are again annotated, they are explained in a detailed manner. Okay. And you can go with the study of the primary as well as tertiary structure for the same protein. Primary information you will get from NRL3D, and the tertiary structure you can go with your PDB, and you can just study the primary and tertiary level at the same time. Okay, so this is what is our UniProt. We have talked about UniProt number of times. So this is the most convenient of all, the most detailed, the most annotated, and the most accurate of all the databases. We can easily get the information with respect to any protein from this UniProt knowledge base. Okay, and we need to understand that this UniProt knowledge base is being prepared by the help of two databases. We have talked earlier also that there is SwissProt, which contains all the manually annotated and reviewed information on the protein sequences. And there is this TREMB. So all those protein sequences which were prepared by the translation of the nucleotide sequences which are there in our EMBL, they are there in this TREMB. And together, SwissProt and TREMBL, they got to produce our UniProt. Okay, so this was the primary protein sequence database. We will try to use the sequences whenever we want to go with the prediction process. The most convenient will be, we can just extract a faster sequence, retrieve a faster sequence from this UniProt knowledge base. Okay. So the characteristics of SwissProt, because I talked about that UniProt is made up of the two, SwissProt and TREMB. So SwissProt is having a number of information. You will have the information with respect to the function, the post-translational modification, what about the domains, the secondary structure, the quaternary structure, about the similarity to other proteins, the diseases related to this particular protein, and many more information is there. We can go through the database later on. And then TREMBL, that is the translated version of our EMBL. EMBL is European Molecular Biology Laboratory, and it is a database that is containing the nucleotide sequences. Okay, so when these nucleotide sequences, when they go with the process of translation, then we get this TREMBL. So all the copies of these translated versions of nucleotide, they're deposited in TREMBL. I had talked earlier also that it had those two sections. One was connected to SwissProt, the other one was having certain other modifications. Okay, but presently the two databases, they are there and they are working together under the UniProt knowledge base. So this is how the SwissProt or the UniProt flat file looks like. Okay, so this you can just see here. This is this ID, AC, DT, DE, GN, OS, OC. So whenever you want to read, you want to just extract information with respect to your protein sequence, you will go through the flat file or the text file. Okay, so ID is representing the identification. Okay, so this is the identification name. You can just identify this protein by this name. This is a standard protein. It belongs to primates. And this is the information with respect to the number of amino acids. Then what about the accession number? So P01588, this is the accession number of our protein. The date of entry, DT is representing the date of entry. So 21st July 1986 was the day when this sequence was being submitted in the UniProt knowledge base. Okay, so date of entry, you can see the three times you can see DT, DT, DT. The reason is that the first time it was actually being submitted after first review, after the second review. The description, what is the name of the protein? So this is erythropoietin precursor. The gene name from which this protein being produced is EPO. The species for which we are talking about is the Homo sapiens, and this is the organism classification, the detailed taxonomy of this particular protein. Okay, so reference, we will talk about what about this protein. Whosoever had submitted the researcher, he must have done some kind of research, and based on that research, he had gone with the publication as well. So these references will let you know about the information with respect to the publication. What about the research articles? In which particular database, like Medline is there. You can see here in Medline, this particular research article, isolation and characterization of genomic and cDNA clones of human erythropoietin is there. And this is containing the information with respect to this particular protein. The CC is representing the comment lines. Okay. Comment lines as in what about the function, what about the subcellular location, you can see here, tissue specificity, pharmaceutical information if it is there, and what about the database information. Okay, so all this information you'll see at the CC line, that is the comment lines. DR is representing cross references. So the sequence which we have got here, it must have got a nucleotide sequence as well. Okay, so nucleotide, because based on the translation of this nucleotide, we have got this protein. So this nucleotide is the information with respect to this nucleotide you will get at the EMBL, that is the cross reference for this particular protein. Okay, these are the keywords by which you can just go through the link for this particular protein. Okay, and these are the feature tables which are representing what about the number of chains in the protein. Okay, and other information with respect to the interactions. Okay, and what about other interactions. Then all this is under the feature table, and the sequence comes from this SQ. So sequence is there, 193 amino acids are there. This is the molecular weight, and sequence starts from here, M to R. And I talked about the single letter codes of our amino acids. So all these are representing the single letter codes, representing the amino acids, okay? And this one is the FASTA format. We talked about the FASTA format earlier as well. So FASTA format is a format that is representing just the sequence. Okay, the sequence is in FASTA format. First line is the header line, starting with the greater than sign. And from the second line onwards, we'll have the amino acid. The amino acids are there again in the single letter code. We will be using only FASTA format for today's practical, because this is the format that is representing our primary sequence. If you want to go with the secondary structure prediction, we need to have an amino acid chain. If you want to go with the second, the tertiary structure prediction, we need to have an amino acid chain. Okay, so what we can do is that we can just take an example. An example can be this SwissProt sequence. Okay, so there are other databases as well. Like besides the, our primary, we are having composite, we are having tertiary databases. So I won't go in detail with the composite sequence databases. Just I'll give a brief info about these composite sequence databases. Like for example, NRDB, okay, OWL, and SP and TREMBL, like we talked about UniProt KB. So it can be considered to be a composite sequence database as well. So these databases, what they are doing, they are containing information and they are collecting information from various other databases. Okay, like NRDB is a non-redundant database. Non-redundant refers to when we are not considering repetition of sequences. Okay, so the sequences with the same name, with the same chain, shouldn't be there in this particular database. So it is said to be a non-redundant database, and this will comprise all the sequences which it we just collect from PDB, SwissProt, PIR, GenPAT, and the GenPAT updates. Okay, similarly, OWL is there. OWL is having a SwissProt, PIR, GenBank, NRL3D. Okay, and the UniProt is again there, comprising of SwissProt and TREMBL. Okay, so all these sequences which are there, they are non-redundant and they should be non-identical. Okay, and by the use of these composite sequence database, you can get information with respect to multiple databases. Then the second category, the major category was the secondary type of databases, and they are also said to be the pattern databases. Okay, so the pattern database is said to be those patterns or those regions of similarity which we call as motifs also, which are present when we are trying to find out similarity between sequences. Okay, so you will have a number of protein sequences. There are a number of protein sequences. If we try to understand that what about these protein sequences, if there is a similarity between these protein sequences, then we will just go with the process of alignment. We will try to search out all the similar regions. If we are getting a single section of similar region, we will consider a single a kind of database, that is the ProCite database. If we are having multiple similar regions or multiple motif regions, then we will categorize all those proteins into print database. Okay, so based on the presence of similar regions, patterns or motif regions, we are having all these types of databases. ProCite is there, okay, so print is there, PFAM is there, profile is there, block is there, and identify is there. You can see here what are the primary sources of our databases. So SwissProt is there, SwissProt and TREMBL, PFAM is there, profile is there, block is there, identify is there, okay, and these are the information which they are carrying. Okay, so what is the need to go with the pattern databases? So the need to go with the pattern databases is just because I told you we need to understand about the sequences, because the way the sequences are related, they will be related in the structure as well, and if there is similarity in the structure, you will see similarity in functions again. Okay, so based on this information, you need to understand that patterns will give you information with respect to the homology between the sequences, the similarity between the sequences, what amount of information is similar and what amount of information is dissimilar. So what about the information with respect to the variation process? Okay, and structure and functional roles you will get to understand by the information you collect from these motif regions. Okay, and we can use these motif regions to go with the diagnostic patterns as well. We can create certain patterns where we will consider the similar regions or the dissimilar regions. Okay, and based on all this, we can go with the information and we can collect the information with respect to sequence, structure and function. Okay, so all this was about the pattern databases. Okay, and then we'll go with this, you can just see. So I was talking about the patterns. So these are certain patterns. Okay, so these patterns are just representing the first line. You can just see the first section is representing the sequences, and in the second section you can just see there are patterns. Okay, so in the patterns you can see these patterns are representing similarity. So this is representing similarity. There is some dissimilarity here, but mostly we can just see that the sequences, they are representing similarity. Okay, so this kind of pattern will be said to be a motif region. Okay, so here you can see in this particular slide that there are these, I just open all these sections of this slide. Okay, so I talked about the different kinds of databases. Okay, so there was this single motif methods, we were having multiple motif regions. Okay, and so we were having, based on the single motif regions, we are having the most common one, that is ProCite. Okay, and based on the multiple motif region, we are having our print. Okay, so print is something which is representing the presence of multiple motif regions. Okay, so this is ProCite if we are having single motif region or a section which is representing similarity at a single section. All those protein sequences, they will be deposited in ProCite. Okay, so all these proteins which are being aligned, there are number of proteins, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So all these proteins, they are aligned. If all these proteins are having a single section, they will be kept in the ProCite. Okay, and the exact matching. But if there is not exact matching, then they are kept in the other database, that is identify. Okay, then the other one, that is print and block. So print is representing multiple motif regions. Okay, so these multiple motif regions are as in, there are multiple motif regions, and they are kept identical motif regions in the print section. But if we are not having the identical motif regions, then we will keep them in the block section. Okay, similar as well as the dissimilar regions. Okay, so all this is there. then profile is there. Profile will consider all the proteins and in a library manner, the full domain alignment method, what it will be, I'll talk in my later slides. Okay, so ProCyte, I'll start with ProCyte. ProCyte is something you can see here. Just so this was the first protein database, okay, and with respect to the patterns, I'm talking with respect to patterns. So if I'm talking with respect to patterns, then ProCyte is the first database. Okay, so this first database is something that was being prepared by the help of presence of motif regions. Okay, so by the help of these motif regions, we got these ProCytes, and based on these ProCytes, there are regular expressions. Regular expressions are the regions which are representing the similar regions only. Okay, and they are said to be seed patterns again, because these patterns are produced on similarity. These are the patterns being produced when the sequences were aligned, they were tried to match, and only the similar regions, the motif regions, were extracted. Okay, the source of database by which we have taken these proteins are obviously our SwissProt. It is this SwissProt from which we have taken the primary sequences, and based on the presence of one single motif region, we went to the creation of this ProCyte. So this is a concept of this ProCyte database. Okay, again, we are having a format for this ProCyte. You can see there is identification number. We are having this accession number. The date of entry is there. Okay, what about the description of the sequence? You will get a brief description. And this is the pattern. Pattern is actually representing pattern. Batayega aapko kahan par similarity hai aur kahan par dissimilarity hai. Similarity is representing there is no mutation. Dissimilarity is representing there is variation. Ki yahan par mutation hua hoga. It can be a possibility ki there had been a substitution, insertion, or deletion that went with the dissimilarity of that particular section. And in this case, pattern is being produced only when we are trying to align multiple sequences. We are considering more than two sequences. ये pattern जब हम ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा sequences को align करके find out करते हैं, just trying to find out similar sections and dissimilar sections separately, so that will give you a pattern. Okay, NR is the information with respect to this particular sequence. And CC is the comment line again, and DR is representing the cross references. You will have the same sequence with these number of IDs. You can just go with the cross reference. Okay, and then ProCyte is having two sections. ProCyte mein do sections hai. Ek to ye pattern hai aapka, pehli jo aapki file hai, and then there is this DO file. Ye documentation file hai, it is having an ID. ये जो डॉक्यूमेंटेशन फाइल है ये प्रोसीड करेगी विद दिस पर्टिकुलर डॉक्यूमेंटेशन फाइल एंड यू विल हैव अ ब्रीफ डिस्क्रिप्शन अबाउट योर प्रोटीन. ठीक है, तो जितने भी प्रोटीन्स दे हैव कंसीडर्ड, ऑल दोस प्रोटीन्स आर देयर विद द इंफॉर्मेशन टू द मोटिफ रीजन. ओके, यहाँ आपने देखा दिस इज द बैक्टीरियल ऑप्शन 1. दिस इज अ काइंड ऑफ अ पैटर्न एंड ऑल दीज प्रोटीन्स दे आर एक्चुअली इन्वॉल्व विद दिस पैटर्न. All these proteins with these IDs, they are there in SwissProt, and all these proteins, they are having the same pattern. Okay, and with the description about this particular protein family, it is there in this particular page. So this is ProCyte, and after the ProCyte, there is this Sprint database. So this Sprint database is actually being produced when we consider more than one motif region. ओके, सो प्रिंट में हम जो कंसेप्ट कंसीडर कर रहे हैं, दैट इज अ कंसेप्ट दैट इज सेड टू बी फिंगरप्रिंट कंसेप्ट. इन बायोइनफॉर्मेटिक्स वी आर कंसीडरिंग इट अ फिंगरप्रिंट कंसेप्ट. सो द फिंगरप्रिंट कंसेप्ट इज सच एज कि वी आर कंसीडरिंग कि एक से ज्यादा मोटिव रीजंस होंगे एंड ऑल दोज मोटिव रीजंस आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर द इंफॉर्मेशन दैट वी कलेक्ट फ्रॉम दीज सेकेंडरी डेटाबेसेस. Okay, and based on this, we have all the protein sequences aligned, and iski jo manually annotated information hai, you will get from your print database. Okay, again, you can see here, these are all sequences. These sequences, they were aligned, and we have got multiple motif regions. Yeah, agar aap iska text file format dekhoge, you will get all these sequences. They are somehow related to each other, and they are having those common regions or the motif regions. Okay, So this was the print, and again the file is represented here. You can find out what about the summary of with respect to the proteins which are there in that family. Okay, this is again one another example of opsin. Profiles and PFAMs. Okay, so this is again another database. हमने motif की बात करी थी, ठीक है? And motif was Procyte and Print. So Procyte was having a single motif. Print में जितने भी sequences हैं, they were having more than one motif region, ठीक है? But we were considering only the similar regions, only the motif regions. लेकिन जो information है, जब protein की आप बात कर रहे हो, तो besides similar regions, we will have some dissimilar regions also. The regions which are showing variation. And I told you कि variation का मतलब है कि we are considering mutation. So mutation का reason होगा substitution, insertion या फिर deletion. And based on this कि हमारे पास motif region तो है ही, we are also considering our variation regions or those regions which are representing substitution, insertion or deletion, that is index. And based on this, there are databases, there is profile and there is PFAM. Profile is a simpler form of this database when we are considering the approach and we are considering a model of HMM, then we will talk about the PFAM database. What is HMM? You will understand in the next session we will have in the secondary structure prediction process. Okay, so blocks in identify, you can see there are advantages for storing motifs in a raw form, and that is the reason these blocks in identify were produced. Okay, so what they are doing, they are processing all the information they are getting from the other secondary databases, like block and identify are taking information from Procyte family database, or they are taking information from print family database. Okay, and they are trying to connect how these information can be converted into a useful information, how they can just extract the useful information from this and cover what amount of families if they want to go with the information analysis. Okay, so this is, these are a brief information for secondary database. This is again the format of this block database, ID, AC, DTDE. So identification number, accession number, the date of entry, description, pattern, the cross references, all this is there. Okay, so I talked about profile. Profile is just similar to the RAT only. We are considering the penalties, the mutations, the indels, that is substitution and insertion and deletion. Wherever you can see these indels, you need to understand I am considering two things. Insertion, because I am considering the, it can be a possibility that generations before all these protein sequences were identical to each other, giving a 100% similarity match, but just because of the mutational changes or the variation caused, they had this mutational changes, this variation, this amount of difference. Okay, so this amount of difference is caused just, it can be a case of substitution, that the amino acid being substituted by any other amino acid, or the amino acid at that particular position may had been deleted, or it can be a possibility that a new amino acid it got inserted at some of the position at your amino acid chains. Okay, so all these are considered, and based on this in the profile databases, we are having different sections, and this is again the format for our profile database. Okay, so whenever we go with the study of these databases, our main motive is we need to understand ki bhai similarity hogi in the sequences, then there will be similarity in structure and there will be similarity in function, and through these databases we will just get to know how we can go with the analysis of structures and functions. Okay, but now further we need to understand how they look in three dimension. Okay, so with respect to the three dimensional structures of proteins, you need to go with the study of databases which are there, the tertiary structure databases. There is SCOPE, there is CAP, and there is PDB and PDB sum as well. Okay, so this is the example I'll show you in my practical section. Okay, so this is PDB. PDB is maintained by RCSB. From here, you can just go with all sorts of tertiary structures. The need for PDB is because we are having so many tertiary structures. So all those which are being prepared by X-ray crystallography or NMR spectroscopy, all those structures, they are submitted in this protein data bank database. Okay. And then there is SCOPE, the structural classification of proteins. You will get all the detailed information with respect to your protein structure through this particular database. Okay, then CAT is also there, the classification, architecture, topology, homology, homologous proteins database, and it is also giving us an annotated information, detailed information with respect to our protein. Okay, so all this was about the proteins. We are having the three major categories, the primary one, the secondary one, the tertiary one. Okay, so we need to extract our information from these databases. If you want to go with the primary structure, we can go to UniProt, PIR, MIPS. If you want to go with the secondary or the motif study or the pattern study, we can go to ProCyte, Print, PFAM, Block, Identify. Okay, and when we want to study just the 3D structure and the detailed information with respect to that 3D structure, we can go to CAD, Scope, or PDB. Okay, so what about how we can just extract the information? I'll let you know just in my practicals. So we can start with the practicals now. And with respect to the theory section, you can just mail me or you can contact me on my number. We can discuss any sort of questions you are having. And you can also message me in the chat now. We can start with the questions again. Okay.